We make things. We use our hands, minds, and machines to build, to fix, to improve. We're known as do-it-yourselfers, home improvement fans, fix-it fanatics, inventors. At our core, though, we're all makers. So let's jump in and make something. Hi, I'm Ron Hazelton. You know, a door that's sticky in the summer and drafty in the winter, well, that's just double trouble. And when it's the most heavily used door of the house, as it is in my case, it's doubly annoying. The solution? Replace it with one that fits like a glove and seals out weather 12 months a year. Once my doorway is finished, I'm heading to the Peachtree State to lend a hand installing a range hood. Now the challenge here? Cutting through a brick wall to put it in. So how about it? Let's make a house call. Well, our old kitchen door has served us well, but it is a wooden door, and that means that in the summertime, when the humidity rises, it swells or expands and can be kind of difficult to open. In the wintertime, it shrinks or gets smaller, and that has created drafts around the edge of the door. So, what I'm going to do is replace it with a new state-of-the-art insulated door. And I think the new door is going to work well enough, so I may be able to eliminate my storm door. Well, the first thing I'm going to do is take down the old kitchen door, and that means removing this hinge pin right here. Now, I'll admit, in the past, I have used a screwdriver to do that by putting the tip right up here and hammering on the end. But you know what? A screwdriver is not a striking tool, and using it that way can really damage it. So I'm going to use this instead. Now, this is a standard cold chisel. I've made a slight modification. On a belt sander, I've kind of ground it a little bit right here, so that instead of having a blunt edge like this, it's got a rather sharp edge. That's going to allow me to get a good grip on the edge of that pin right there and drive it up, just like this. I remove the remaining pins and lift off the door. Cutting through the caulk around the edge of the casing and at the joints will let me pry off the trim without damaging either the wood or the wall. Driving the tapered cold chisel between the casing and the jamb gently wedges the two pieces apart and gives me the space I need to insert a pry bar. Outside, I remove the screws that hold the storm door in place, then lift it off. Then I tackle the outside trim in much the same way as the interior casing. Now the casing is off, both on the outside and on the inside, and the only thing that's holding this frame in place right now are some nails, probably three or four on each side. I'm going to cut through those using this reciprocating saw. Okay. Goodbye, old door frame. A replacement door like the one I'm putting in here shouldn't require too many changes to the opening, but I am going to have to make a couple of modifications. One is I'm going to have to cut back the flooring about a half an inch here because the threshold on the door that I'm putting in is slightly wider than the door that I took out. So I'll do that using a circular saw. I've set my blade depth just to cut through the material I want to remove here. Now this strip came out of here nice and cleanly. I just have to make one other modification, and that's to put this piece of half-inch plywood down here. It's going to act as a shim. That'll help bring the bottom of the door up closer to the surface of the floor here. Now I want to check this to make sure that it's level in two directions. It's pretty good in this direction, maybe just a tad low on that end. Let me check it this way. Ah, this way it's not so good. it's kind of tipping toward the outside. So what I'm going to have to do here is put some shims in, starting down at this end. Let's try that. Okay. Pretty good.
I place shims every 6 or 8 inches and nail them in place. Then trim off the excess with a Japanese handsaw. Next, I put adhesive-backed aluminum tape on top of the sill to act as a moisture barrier. Then install a new piece of wood trim. The new door I'm putting in is made of composite fiberglass with a polystyrene core that will insulate against summer heat and winter cold up to 5 times better than a standard wood door, helping to keep the house comfortable year-round. To ensure a watertight seal around the edges, I apply sealant to the door sill and to the nailing flange on the door frame.
Now, the whole idea here is just to tip this up into the opening so that that sealant I put on the bottom doesn't get smeared around.
With the door up, I nail through only the top corners of the flange. Before I go any further, I need to step inside and check things out.
Looks pretty good. Now there are 3 things that I want to check for. First of all, I want to make certain that the frame is square. And I'm going to do that by measuring the 2 diagonals and comparing the numbers. If it's square, they should be the same. Okay, this one is 87. And this one, and that's also 87. So we're in good shape here. Now the next thing I want to do is check to make sure that the sides of the door frame are vertical or plumb. And I'm going to, in this case, put the level on the hinges. That's right on. Now the last thing I want to check for is the margin, that is the gap between the door and the edge of the frame. It should be uniform, the same width or thickness. And in this case, looking real good.
Next, I insert shims between the door jamb and the framing. The idea here is to make sure the sides of the door frame are perfectly straight, and nails driven through the shims will make sure the jambs stay that way. Finally, I trim off the excess.
Well, I've checked the measurements on the inside. Everything was square and plumb, and we've installed our shims. Now I can go ahead and finish nailing off this flange.
To further seal the sides of the frame on the exterior, I apply more aluminum tape on top of the nailing flange. There's hardly a project that I start that doesn't require an unplanned trip to the home improvement center. This time, I've got to pick up some wood for the outside trim. I'm gluing together 2 pieces of wood, a rectangular section and a drip cap, to make the top trim. The drip cap will divert water away from the door opening and prevent moisture from getting inside the frame. Just as I finish nailing, I hear a tiny voice behind me.
What is it, honey? You want to go bike riding? Here, let me put your helmet on. Okay, I'll have to take a little break here, okay? Here, put your helmet on. We'll take a little break so you can do some bike riding. Yeah, we gotta get our priorities straight here, right? Let me see. Look at Daddy. You know what? I haven't had my good morning kiss yet. Can I have a good morning kiss? Mwah. Okay. Be careful.
Well, now that the really important business is taken care of, I can nail up the side trim. The final thing to do out here is to apply sealant around the edges and tool off the excess with my finger.
Well, except for a bit of paint, that finishes up things here on the outside. I'm going to step inside now and start on the casing.
I insert some fiberglass insulation around the frame, then it's time to put up the trim. Now, the original came off in good shape, so I'm going to reuse it. I'm also reusing the flooring transition strip that I took off before I removed the old door. Good pry bars and patience are what make this kind of recycling possible. One of the beauties of a good quality pre-hung door like this is that the hardware borings and mortises are already done. All I have to do is slip the lock set parts into place.
Ah, there's nothing like the sound of a finely crafted door. And you know what? This door is going to work just as well in the heat of summer as it will in the cold of winter. And because it's insulated, I don't have to have my storm door out here. I'd say I've got the best of both worlds. Ah, black rubber heel marks. You know, they can be really tough to get off your floor. But you know what? I learned how to remove them in, of all places, an airport, where they have miles of corridors and tens of thousands of feet a day. And you'll never guess what they used. A tennis ball. Take a utility knife and cut an X in the ball. Then take a broomstick, push the tennis ball on the end, and you have got a black mark eraser extraordinaire. Ardina and Johnny Williams of Pooler, Georgia have asked for a house call.
They want to install a kitchen exhaust fan, and I'm going to see if I can help them out.
So I understand we got a kitchen project today.
Yes.
We need an oven hood bin installed.
Okay, let's go and take a look around. Is there one there now?
No, there's nothing.
Okay.
This is where it needs to go.
You don't even have one. You've never had one.
No. Never, not since we moved in.
And why do you want one now, have you decided?
Well, every time we turn on the stove in any way, it sets off our heat and smoke detector on the other side of the doorway.
Okay. Now, have you purchased the unit yet?
Yes. We have it out in the garage.
Okay, would you mind bringing it in? I just want to check a couple of things.
Yes.
Okay. You need two things to install a range hood: electricity, which we have right here, and a way to direct the exhaust. Now, we could go up with the exhaust through the cabinets, but in this case, you'd see the exhaust pipe right here. So instead, we're going to go through the wall, which means we not only have to go through this wall board right here, but also through the brick wall on the outside of the house.
Johnny and Ardina start by checking to make sure there's enough space between the cabinets.
I think that'll work.
Then we'll find the center of the wall and follow the manufacturer's detailed instructions to mark the position for the cutout.
This is what we're going to cut out right here.
X marks the spot for the cutout.
Now, this is where the electrical wire will come through right here. This is where the exhaust will go out. And those, of course, have to match up with these same openings in the back of the exhaust fan. So now it's time to do some cutting. The idea is to push it through the wall. There you go.
Using a wallboard saw, Johnny cuts along the lines we've just drawn.
Not connected, like
as is often the case with home improvement, the empty space we expected to find behind the wall is occupied by a copper water pipe. The only choice is to detour the pipe around the opening. To do this, we remove the cabinet and enlarge the opening in the wall. While the wall is open, we run the new electrical wire for the range hood. Then, reroute and re-solder the copper pipe. To close up the opening, we'll attach 1x3 cleats to the inside of the wall at the top and bottom. Secure the new wallboard to these cleats, and then patch the seams with joint tape and compound.
Well, that was quite a detour, wasn't it? But we have gotten that pipe out of the way, and right now we're looking at the back side of the exterior brick wall. We're going to start cutting through now, and I'm going to do that by boring 4 holes at each corner. Where we want the exterior hole to be. I'm going to use a carbide-tipped bit and a hammer drill. Now, this drill actually hammers as it rotates. It's going to allow us to go through that brick a lot faster. Johnny and I share the drilling duty, and before long, we have the corner holes bored out.
Oh, okay. Don't slap me.
You okay?
Yeah.
That was fast.
From the outside, we drill a series of holes between the corners to perforate the opening. Then, using a hammer and chisel, we remove the loose brick and mortar. We're going to start our actual installation here on the outside by putting in this wall cap. This is where the exhaust air will actually exit the building. Now, attached to that will be a short piece of duct. This was 24 inches long when we got it. We simply cut it down to length. It'll slip up inside here, and this entire unit will go through the wall. We'll seal it around the edges here with some caulk, and then attach it on the inside to the range hood. I'll use sheet metal screws to attach the duct to the wall cap, and then seal the joint with duct tape. A heavy bead of masonry adhesive will secure the cap to the brick wall and keep it sealed from wind and weather. Once the duct has come through the wall, I use tin snips to cut the corners and then bend the edges back flush with the wall. A flange around the duct makes a tight seal to the hood. Because the underside of the cabinet is recessed, we'll need to install cleats to provide a mounting surface for the hood. Ardina drives screws through the bottom of the cabinet to attach the cleats. At the electrical outlet, I cut back the insulation and then make the connections for the wiring. Finally, we install four mounting screws to the cleats, driving them only halfway in so that we can slip the slotted mounting holes over the heads.
We are approaching the moment of truth, okay? You'll have two jobs. One will be to take that electrical wire over there and feed it through this hole right here, this connector.
Okay.
Just kind of gently pull it through.
All right.
And then we've put four screws in up there. We want to locate these large holes right here, just below the heads of the screws. And we're going to push this up. And
okay.
Once we get it on the screws, we're going to slide it back to the wall.
All right.
And then tighten the screws up.
Next, we connect the electrical wires to the hood and replace the access panel. Finally, we snap the grease filter in place.
Well, they're cooking away, and I don't hear any smoke alarm.
Yeah, we've got good ventilation now.
Well, I guess we solved that problem.
Yes, and I really appreciate your coming to help us out with that.
Oh, you're very welcome. And the other problem, the one we found inside the wall.
We're glad we didn't have to deal with it alone.
Ah, you could have handled it. Johnny, pleasure working with you.
The smell of those burgers brought the kids running.
That's a great idea. Let's eat!
Doug Everett, an Olympic hockey medalist back in 1932, said, "There are some people who live in a dream world, and there are some who face reality. And then there are those who turn one into the other." I like this because a lot of my home improvement projects start as dreams, and few things are sweeter to me than seeing them become reality. Thanks for watching.
To view today's projects again, visit ronhazelton.com, where you'll find hundreds of how-to videos available 24/7. Free home improvement videos online 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.